Since the first primal spark of creation, man contains that divinity that is within him, contains it, and theologies would say that that divinity will try to express itself. And all the methods that are used, all the paths that are used towards the expression, the path is the expression, and when the expression merges itself in its totality, in its primal source, that is regarded to be the realization. Now, why is it necessary for anyone to become realized? People can carry on in their routine lives. What is there that prompts one or inspires one or urges one to find realization? Man, though he might not know it, is urged ever onwards to find realization because basically man is unhappy. His unhappiness extends through various fields of his life. His home life, work life, life in the environment, life in society. And there he finds that he is not fulfilled. There is always a discrepancy. There are very few people today that could say, honestly say, I am very happy in my job. There are very few people that could honestly say, I am very happy in my home life. There are very few people that could honestly say that I am very happy in my environment and in my society. So, he has found through the teachings of the ages that to find this happiness, it is not necessary to change the environment, but to change oneself. And this desire is within him, it exists within him, even if not at a conscious level, but at the subconscious level, there is this desire. And it is for the fulfillment of this desire, for the search for happiness, that he seeks self-realization. Self-realization means a total integration of mind, body, and spirit. And that total integration, that self-realization, is synonymous with God realization. Because when man integrates himself, he also at the same time integrates his small self with the big self. So there, in the diversities that were in life, in the incongruities that he experienced, he has found now that which is unity amidst all the diversity. Now, the compelling force, where does the compelling force exist in man? That compelling force exists in every cell of our bodies and in every cell of the subtle matter we call mind. Now, mind too can be divided into various facets. You have the conscious mind, then you have the subconscious mind, and you have the superconscious mind. And it is the force of the superconscious mind that spurs one on. Now, there is no particular location where the subconscious mind is, or the conscious mind is, or where the superconscious mind is. They all form part and parcel of each other as a whole. But we use these terms just for the purpose of explanation. These three aspects of mind are forever interpenetrating each other. Now, when people do certain kinds of spiritual practices to find integration through various other movements in the world, what they do that they are stirring up things and impressions that are in the subconscious mind. The subconscious mind, as we have always said, contains the memory box of millions of years of existences and millions of years of experiences. In Sanskrit, we call it sanskaras. We can, for our purposes, call them impressions. Now, by using methods that stir up these impressions without resolving them, can lead a person to many kinds of problems. We start off by trying to create a balance, but a greater balance comes to the fore. All the animalisms that we have in us, we have been through the animal kingdom, so therefore the nature of animalism is also in us. And by doing certain kinds of practices, instead of subduing the animalism, we are waking it up. Because in the practice, the superconscient, superconsciousness is forgotten. Now, we have various methods used by psychologists and psychiatrists that try and fathom the subconscious to go deeply to the roots of problems. But what is the use of analyzing darkness? It does not resolve the problem. Analyzing darkness, we would only find and know it to be darkness. The element that is missing is the light of the superconscious. Now, how do we draw upon the light of the superconscious to get rid of the darkness? With our methods of meditation, two things are happening. On the one hand, we are bringing to the fore those hidden subconscious impressions, and at the same time, through Guru Shakti, we are stirring and drawing upon the superconscious. So on the one hand, the impressions are stirred up from below, and on the other hand, the power that is drawn from above, from the superconscient, from superconsciousness, the stirrings of the subconscious mind is subdued and no stressing is felt. That is the purpose of Guru Shakti. Now, these things have to happen for a person to reach enlightenment, self-realization. The subconscious, with its impressions of millions of years, could be called as darkness, and we are infusing that darkness with the light of the superconscious, so the darkness disappears. Now, we have psychiatrists and psychiatrists, for example. I hope I'm not bringing this up because we have a psychiatrist here. A person like Dr. Fenter is very successful in his treatments because of his deep study of the superconscious. Superconscious, he could impart that to the patient, while many other psychiatrists examine the darkness only and draw forth from the subconscious, which could be very, very terrible. So there the problem is not resolved. It is not resolved. Even if a man is brought face to face with a problem and he is not shown a way how to get rid of the problem. If your face is dirty and you look in the mirror, you will see the dirty face. So what the psychiatrist also has to do is to show how to wash the face, so when you look in the mirror again, your face is clean. Now, two things happen there, that you don't only clean the face, but the mirror too could be dirty. The mirror too could be dirty, so in the process, the face has to be cleaned and the mirror has to be polished. Now, how do we do that? How do we do that? The only method, the royal method that must be used by psychologists and psychiatrists, even before they practice, is to study and develop the ability, as Dr. Fenter has done, to be able to infuse the person and his problems with the superconscious. So, all of people in this world, whichever work they do, they can be carpenters, professors, bricklayers, street sweepers, they too could develop the ability to impart the superconsciousness. The psychiatrist would do it on a higher level, a street sweeper on a lower level, but it is also a contribution to society at large. And the best way to contribute is to find the balance within ourselves first, and then to have the method to impart it. So, for man to be happy and to reach the state of self-realization, it is a necessary must that the three aspects of man, the body, mind, and the spirit, must be used as a whole, as a totality. And all unhappiness in this world, all imbalance in this world, is because we are not using ourselves as total beings. Now, totality might not be achieved overnight. Remember, you have millions of impressions in that subconscious of yours. And all those impressions, sanskaras, has created a turbulence there. And the subconscious, with its turbulences, must influence the conscious mind in the various actions of life. A person does wrong. We always say we do not condemn the sinner, but the sin. Fine. Now, if a person does wrong, say he murders, steals, robs, whatever, what makes him do that? Now, if we have the strength in ourselves to ask that question and find the answer, we will develop the ability to love that person. Because we know that certain acts are done because of mental compulsion. The impressions of the subconscious mind are so powerfully portrayed in the conscious mind, in the waking state, that that poor man, that poor sick man, cannot help but do the actions that he is doing. And when we understand this, we can learn to love everyone. Man basically is good. Man has the divine spark in him. The divinity permeates every cell of his body and mind. There is no doubt about that. But it is veiled. It is veiled. The combinations of the divinity through various aspects of his life, influenced by the sanskaras that are there, make him act in a manner which might be antisocial. So therefore, to repeat, we do not condemn the sinner, we condemn the sin. And in the condemnation of the sin, we try and show which is the right path. And the right path would be towards creating a balance, creating that integration, which is self-realization, and self-realization is God-realization. Okay, Vijay. So, good. Who's next?
On an earlier tape, you spoke of the balance between the tamas, the rajas, the sattvas.
That is.
What worries me is there appears to be no possibility for progression of the entire population. If this is so, that as one person progressed, a new soul were coming in.
Beautiful.
This is not a bad thing. Should we not hope for a general development?
We should hope for a general development, but we should not live in a fool's paradise. Because man of 2,000 years ago, during the time of Christ, is still the same man today. There might have been technological advances, but not necessarily spiritual advances. There will always be a percentage of people reaching higher states of consciousness, a higher stage of evolution. But to find that evolutionary progression with total humanity would be an impossibility. Impossibility. There are people that promise an age of enlightenment where everyone will be enlightened. But if we study past history, we have seen that this has not been so. Man still expresses his basic instincts in the same way that he did 2,000 years ago. Now, as far as the three gunas which you spoke about, the rajas, tamas and sattva, they will forever be existing. The rajas, tamas and sattva, the three gunas, too, are eternal. If we regard divinity to be eternal, then the manifestation of divinity, rajas, tamas and sattva, are eternal too. Being the manifestation of an eternal manifester. Now, rajas, tamas and sattva are the qualities that govern the working of all natural laws. Now, in the progression of a person, in the progression towards self-realization, what happens is this, that he is not destroying rajas, he is not destroying tamas, but in his life, sattva is dominating. Sattva is predominating and rajas and tamas are not destroyed, but they are subdued. They are subdued so that they do not gain precedence in his life. And the person that lives a sattvic life, in whom the guna, the attribute, the quality of sattva is dominant, his life becomes more and more happier. So we that are bound by natural laws must of necessity and necessarily live and be governed by the three gunas. But here, how do we make sattva dominate? We make sattva dominate by our practices. By our practices of meditation, morning and evening, and throughout the day, a conscious effort by trying to do things that are right. The only thing that distinguishes man from animal is his intellect. And even a person who is not endowed with a high intellect, he is still endowed with common sense. And he can recognize what is right and wrong according to his level of development. So if he is sincere and honest to himself, he will act in that manner according to his development. And action for one man might be good, the same action for another man might be bad. it depends upon his understanding. And as man progresses in understanding, as man progresses in his mental conceptions, his power of discrimination would also increase. This is also a path to self-realization. So, being embodied beings, living in the relative field of life and being governed by the laws of nature, we can use the same instrument of the mind and the intellect to gain, to reach the stage of self-realization. This instrument of the mind, we've said it is very cunning. This instrument of the mind can make one retrogress and it can make one progress. So, by our meditational practices, as our minds become finer and finer, then automatically the sattvicness in us will come to the fore. And when sattva comes to the fore, the inertia of tamas is subdued. Inertia. Tamas is darkness. So the light of sattva overcomes the darkness. It does not destroy it. Now, when we put on the light in this room, can we say that darkness is destroyed? Darkness too still exists. Darkness exists in spite of this light being there. Because if we switch off the light, darkness is there. Where have we destroyed it? We have subdued it with light. So, the opposites will always be there. Where there is light, there will be darkness. It is like a coin. You cannot have the heads alone. You've got to accept the tails as well. But what do we do with our lives? Are we going to lead it through darkness when the light is there and it is so easy for us to switch on the light? And that is what we do. That is the purpose of our practices. And to live in light is happiness. To live in nescience or darkness is unhappiness. One takes one to self-realization while the other stagnates one or even retrogresses one. Okay, well, good, fine.
Should I ask evil,
there has
people, where there's good, there has to be
evil and good are only conceptions of the relative field. What we have to do in our evolutionary progress is to go even beyond evil and good. Is to go beyond evil and good. But while we are in the relative field, we accept the conception of good and evil because these conceptions are those which stabilizes man and stabilizes society. And for that purpose of the recognition of evil and good, all religions and theologies have their commandments. Now, how to overcome the evil? How to subdue the evil? Evil and good can also be synonymous with the gunas. They're synonymous with the gunas. We allow good to dominate, then evil is subdued, perhaps not destroyed. A good transformation can take place, not in the evil or the good, but in the expression of it in man's life. So man is transformed. Man becomes more self-integrated. Now, a sick person, an imbalanced person, mentally imbalanced, he might not have the conception of what is good and what is bad. What is his position? What is the position of a man that cannot recognize the difference between good and bad, because he has some mental aberration, perhaps. He cannot cognize the difference. What is his position as far as self-realization goes? His position would be that his action, because of not having the consciousness of his actions, he would not be bound karmically. His life will be lived in a stagnation which will not be retrogression, and neither would it be progress. But for that man too, no hope is lost, because we do believe in another life to come. And he would have his chance again with a balanced mind, with a reasoning mind, with an intelligent mind, where he can discriminate between good and evil. And in the discrimination, we let good dominate our daily actions, our daily lives, and that is the path to happiness.
How does one find this good and evil? Because, I mean, you mentioned killing just now. This is evil, but I'm killing war. To kill and defend yourself, but defend an enemy.
True.
Same as stealing, and starving, and stealing.
True. That is very true. How to define what is good and evil? Now, I think we discussed this last week, that what could be good in certain circumstances might be evil in other circumstances. I think we used the analogy that in a Western country, in South Africa, monogamy is the thing which is regarded to be good, and polygamy would be bad. But you might go to other countries like Tibet and elsewhere, Mohammedan countries, for example, where polygamy is supposed to be good. So the definition of good and evil is dependent upon the environment and the man's relation to his particular environment. Now, this too, of course, is from man's point of view. But from the divine point of view, there is no good and there is no evil. There is only equal. Here, from down here, the ocean seems very, very turbulent. The waves are rushing high. But if we go up in an aeroplane, then from there, it would seem calm. So it depends upon our perspective. Our perspective tells us what is good and what is evil. The higher we go, the vaster the view. The higher we go, the vaster the view. And in the path of evolution, when we reach very high, everything would appear the same. Then discrimination too won't be needed, because we have now, in the absolute state, gone even beyond discrimination. So discrimination too is an instrument. It is a tool. A child of standard one does not need to worry about the lessons of a person in BA. We that are in standard one, we worry about the lessons of standard one, and we try to do the best. Now, all the children in the class are not equally intelligent, but they can be equally sincere. One child can get 90%, while another child can get 40%. But the important thing there in living this life is not the percentage we attain, but it is our sincerity. Have we got 40% or 90% as a total person? Have we put ourselves sincerely and honestly into the situation? That brings the value. That brings the progression. All right.
The other one I want to ask is, what is the effect of drug trafficking on the spiritual realm?
The effect of drug taking, I have been told that certain experiences could be had using drugs. But these experiences, they could be very high experiences. I think those are the terms they use. They can feel very uplifted. But the upliftment is temporary. The upliftment is so temporary that when a person comes down from the trip, comes back from the trip, he is not left with a sense of well-being. He would feel more depressed and more uncomfortable because his experience was temporary. What effect could that have on the person's mind? I've also heard it being said that a drug taker, because of the experience he had, spurred him on to genuine non-chemical means of search within himself. Now, so there too for the drug taker, no hope should be lost. Because if his mind can be guided to the very same experiences and better ones that would have a permanent value, a more joyful value, and if this can be shown him, then his desire for drugs would be lessened immediately. And we have found in our meditational practices that people with all different kinds of habits, their desire for the usage of various kinds of things become diminished, more and more diminished, because their systems, mind and bodies become more refined, becomes finer, and they would find taking off grosser things very repugnant to them. They'd shirk away from it gradually. And that happens. So too for the drug taker, there is no hope lost. There's no hope lost. And in this modern world, people want things instantly, as we always say. And it is a misconception that to take a drug will give them self-realization. That is not true. It could be more harmful to them. It could destroy many of their brain cells, for example. It could destroy their bodies because they are becoming dependent on something artificial. They are not dependent upon themselves. Now, spiritual practices make one dependent upon oneself and independent of external things, of grosser things. That is the purpose. So it has been proven by scientists that people doing meditational practices do leave off drugs. They do go away from it gradually. Because with the sense of independence developing in them and not having to be dependent on anything else, they have gained strength to push away the drugs. The grass, I think they call it grass. LSD and
You mentioned about destroying brain cells, and it sort of occurred to me, we were talking recently about the progress of the physical body. Now, apparently, from the time you're born, your brain cells really start decaying. But at least they reproduce to the age of about 30 or something, or 25 or whatever it is, Gracie should know. And thereafter starts declining. Now, what I wanted to know, is there any correlation necessarily between spiritual maturity and physical maturity? Would you find that enlightenment would occur, and some people have made this claim, postulate, that it occurs generally, say, between 30 or 40 or what, something like that. Could you find it happening before or very, very late, when, say, the physical mechanism is really just about ready to shut down? Could it happen?
Now,
it's
pretty A person's spiritual status, his evolutionary status, is not dependent upon physical maturity. If we study great personages in history, we will find that very young boys from a very early age are spiritually enlightened. They might have worked very hard towards that end in previous lives. And when you talk of physical maturity, a boy of 15 or 16 is quite matured, and so is a young girl. But when you talk of the age of 25 or 30 or 35, you would be referring more to mental maturity. Now, what is mental maturity? I have seen people of 70 and 80 that are still immature. Mental maturity comes about by creating this balance in the mind, to use the mind harmoniously with the body and the spirit. That is mental maturity. Mental maturity is that one has also developed a certain amount of discrimination, which is not dependent on intellectuality, but he has developed a certain amount of discrimination whereby he could view something in as a whole. He could view the object as a whole and in its total value. Now, to observe something in its total value can only be done by a self-realized man. But the mentally mature man would find some appreciation of the total value of a thing. The self-realized man will not only see the total value of the thing, but he will live the total value of the thing. He will become one with the object. The subject becomes one with the object and experiences the totality of the object in that oneness. But does the self-realized man? But the mentally mature man will find appreciation of the total value of a thing. He will not only look at the flower, but he will look at the vase as well and the water in it to make this beautiful display. That is the action of a mentally mature man. The mentally mature man would always find a balance in the object and also a balance in the subject, which is himself. Now, to find balance in the object, one has to first be balanced within oneself. But there is no other way. So even to find the slightest appreciation of the totalness of the object, we have to strive for the balance and totality in ourselves. Now, this happens by degrees, by stages, and that is the purpose of all our meditational practices, whereby we gradually develop that mental maturity. Now, if there are any imbalances in the mind as we know it, or the expression of it, then to strengthen that, we infuse the spiritual self of ourselves into that to strengthen it. We bring that light into the darkness. And that is how a man becomes mentally mature. Mental maturity is a prime condition towards self-realization. It does not mean having great powers of the intellect. It does not mean you have to become an Einstein. It's not necessary. Because in the limits of the intellect, if divinity is infused in it, then that limited intellect also becomes limitless. And it is not necessary to express it in verbal means or in analysis, which the intellect does all the time, but it has an experiential value for the mind, then too is fully and totally permeated by the spiritual self, by divinity. So, to recap on your question, physical maturity is not an entire must towards self-realization. Mental maturity, mental balance is one of the prerequisite conditions to reach self-realization. And when the mind becomes more and more balanced, it would definitely affect the body. It would bring a greater calmness to the body because it would appreciate the body too in its higher values. And this is done by the infusion of the spiritual self, the divine self of man. And then finally, the body, the mind, and the spirit becomes one in total integration. And when man is totally integrated, he becomes integrated with the entire universe. Then he can say, ah, I have the universe in the palm of my hands. And that is possible. That is entirely possible and within the range of every man, within the range of everyone sitting here, within the range to reach the self-realization that is required to do this, because self-realization is God-realization. If God is omnipresent, that means he is to the extent of the universe. And if self-realization is synonymous with God-realization, then the universe is identified with me. I and the universe are one. And that is the end and aim for all these striving. We are striving for that. And then we will say, all this is that. All this is that. Okay.
Eugene, I believe that we are all potential bodhisattvas and potential Buddhas, so enlightened people. And for those people who have reached this stage of enlightenment and there's no need for them to be reborn again, where do they go on from there?
If a person reaches the stage of enlightenment, where does he go from there? Where for him to go? Just the realization of the self-realized man is this, that I am here. We, not being all there, must be somewhere else. The stage we are reaching for and striving for is to know that I am here. And this can be appreciated by man's total involvement in the moment. Then he is centered. We operate off-center. Off-center. If you put an axle in the wheel and if the hub is off-center, then the wheel does not run smoothly. It jumps on the road. It jumps on the road. So, what we are trying to do is to become centered, and centering is nowhere else but here, always there. So, what we are trying to find is come away from there. What we are trying to do is come away from there and to come here, because our progression, our evolution is from here to here. We go nowhere. The air in the balloon, after the balloon has been burst or pricked, the air becomes one with the outside air. It went nowhere.
Yeah. Beyond ourselves is to be eccentric.
Pardon?
I say to be beyond ourselves to be eccentric.
Beautiful, yes. Yes.
So there's a complete merging.
It's a complete merging, yes, yes. But then we realize the full value of gear. We realize the full value of gear. Now, I believe in Afrikaans, H-E-R-E also means here. Here means Lord. Huh? Then we realize here, the full value of here.
I just said something good about that. Here in Egyptian language means, here means eternity, and prayer means light.
Right.
So it means to be in position.
Eternal light. Beautiful, 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 beautiful. Very beautiful. Very, very beautiful.
Is that related to Sanskrit Hare, perhaps, which is the first
name? Not necessarily.
Huh.
No. Oh, Hare. Yes, yes. That's good.
Ask this.
Please, please do.
I'm interested in the voice of conscience. Conscience, yes, not consciousness. One so often hears, no, you shouldn't do this, to adjust it, and little bell that rings inside my head. Is this the experience? Is it a voice and experience which is contained in your entity from a possible past connection?
Yes.
What is the mechanism? How does this
function? Yeah. The voice of conscience. What are the mechanics of the voice of conscience? Now, to reply that, we would have to analyze what conscience is. We have to analyze what conscience is. Now, one's conscience represents the totality, the totalness of the man at his present evolutionary status. The totality of the man at his present evolutionary status. That conscience would tell you how far you have now traveled on your way to Salisbury. You have reached Johannesburg and this city and that city. That. Now, to be able to draw on one's present state of evolution would be the greatest stepping stone to further progression. To have cognition, to know how far I am on the path, will map out to us how furthermore to go. Once we map out how far still to go, we would be facilitated in finding the best and easiest ways and means of going there. But now, how do we reach the stage where we can listen to the voice of conscience? Most people are deaf to that voice. Their ears are closed to that voice. Now, as we, through our spiritual practices, go deeper and deeper to the levels of the mind, as we go deeper and deeper to the finer and finer levels of the mind, there, at its finest level, where everything is total up in our sum of life, there one gets the balance. There one sees that two and two has made four, and four has made eight. The answer of the voice of conscience is found there. Conscience speaks from that level to where we have reached. And if we can sincerely listen to that voice, then self-realization is around the corner. Then self-realization is around the corner. Many people confuse the voice of conscience with the little thoughts whirling in their minds. Thoughts that were conditioned by their own thinking and by their own desires and by their own selfishnesses and their own wants. And then they say, oh, a little bird, tell me this. A little voice came up in my head and told me this. But Is it true? Is it not imaginary? Are we sufficiently progressed in our practice to really cognize that voice of conscience? And we are all reaching that. We are all consciously or unconsciously reaching the level where I can speak to myself. When I speak to myself at its finest level, there resides the voice of conscience. There resides the truest guidance for any decision you want to make. Because the decision, that guidance, can only be progressive, can only lead us in the right path, can only make us flow with the current of nature and not against it. And that is the voice of conscience. The voice of conscience resides within the deeper layers of ourselves. And there it sits as king. But we ignore the king. We ignore that king that can command us and guide us what to do, what not to do. It's always for the good. So with our practices, as we reach deeper and deeper and deeper and finer levels of the mind, we all will hear the voice of conscience, as many of our meditators are hearing it now. When they come and tell me, speak to me of the meditations, we sum up the experiences, and truly, there are some of us here who can really say that I hear the voice of conscience, which is always for the good, always for the benefit of themselves and the environment. Okay, Bob. Fine. Good. Next.
You say that when one's in that, one is here now. But what is all this really about transport, being, having the awareness in different places at the same time? That again is, it seems a limited concept. Well, how is one's awareness? Does it circular vision and hearing everything that is to hear at all levels of consciousness?
True, right. I see what you mean. You must have heard the saying that God resides totally in the smallest atom, and God resides totally in the whole universe. Now, this sounds very paradoxical, because how can you fit the immensity of the universe in a single atom? So therefore, we find this paradoxical. Now, this can be experienced. Perhaps it cannot be intellectualized, but it can be experienced. And all the isness is contained in the here-ness. The whole universe is here now. If you analyze the atom, the mechanism in the atom is exactly the same as the mechanism that operates this whole universe. Now, we want to find self-realization within ourselves, and it is the identification of this I with the universal I that will show us, that will make us experience the universe in its entirety, here and now. And at the same time, we will not be oblivious of the atom. Because in every petal of flower, in every petal, the whole universe resides. We confuse in this paradox because of time and space. We look at things from a spatial value, that 12 inches is bigger than 2 inches. Yet, that 12 inches can be contained in a fraction of an inch. Because in order to experience that, we have to experience it from a different dimension. And as the mind expands, as awareness grows, we experience things from a different dimension, which is beyond the space and time. In that dimension, space and time becomes non-existent. Space and time are creations of our minds. But in the realm of beyond the mind, which we do through our meditations, when we go in meditations, we go beyond the limitations of the mind. And by going beyond the limitations of the mind, we are going beyond the limitations of space and time. And in that stage, in that state, the whole universe is found in the atom. Everything is here and now. There's no distance, because distance is space. There's no tomorrow, there's no yesterday, because that is the limitations of time created by ourselves, by our own minds. So to experience, to have the experience and to realize the meaning of the paradox, we have to go beyond the mind. Okay, right.
Guru Raj, you've just answered part of the question I wanted to ask 3 weeks ago and I haven't asked you yet. by this concept of time, I've always thought of it as being a railway line running in a straight shape. And the present is where you're sitting on the track right now. The future is ahead of you and the past is behind you. But in reality, is it not so that the past is riding next to you, and so is the future?
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Yes, the past and the future is riding beside you on your train journey. Because really speaking, the when you speak of the limitations of space and time, then from the relative point of view, we are traveling. But from the absolute point of view, there's no travel. Absolute is complete, and in the completeness of its completion, where is there to go? Therefore, we say, we have to be here. Therefore, we are trying to be here. In that realm, no journey is required. Journeys are required in the relative field, not in the absolute. And what we are trying to do is find the value of the absolute with our limited minds. We are trying to define that which is an impossibility. The infinite cannot be comprehended by that which is finite. So, when we go beyond the limitations of the mind, there we find the infinite, which is inexplicable, unexplainable, but realizable and experienceable. Then, in your train journey, you go nowhere. Because there's no train, and there's no you, and there's nowhere to go. Please.
If you take a hand, put the hand on the bottom. For the end to move from my head to my foot takes time. But for me, I'm there at the same time.
Same time. Beautiful. Oh, lovely. Lovely.
What is so bad about spiritualism that you discourage people from being?
Could you also include in the seances?
You didn't speak about spooks, do you? I discourage people going to spiritualism because it will help man nothing. It will not aid man in any of his spiritual aspirations. It will not aid man. Why go into something? Firstly, a disembodied spirit that has found no rest is an unstable spirit Now by spirit here I mean the subtle body of man. The subtle body of man, because of his intense attachment, because of his intense desires, he cannot free himself. And because of the intensity of the attachment, that he would roam around places that are familiar to him, that were familiar to him when he was in a bodied state. Now, for our personal spiritual progress, why should we take the assistance? Why should we take the assistance of an unstable subtle body when we can progress to stability by finding the stable element within us? The real path of progress is not external. The real path of progress is internal. Research should always be internal, although we have to use external means. But the using of external means, they are regarded to be guides. We guide ourselves towards the inward path by the observation of the outward path. Now, if we have to use, it is not given to all to search within himself. It's not given to all to study on his own. He needs a teacher. Now, if we are looking by external means, the inward path, then let us use a teacher, a good teacher, a stable teacher, and not an unstable spook.
Balaji, what about these people who seem relatively humble, who do communicate on that level? They always have names, well, not always, but often they have names like Silver Birch and Nirmala brought the name Seth. Mm-hmm. And what they say generally is what one would expect of a highly evolved person. Of course, you get the lower ones, but there are also people who generally do seem to bring true wisdom. Now, would a highly evolved person act on that level?
Now,
we become incarnate again.
Now, what happens is this, that in the name of spookism, in the name of guides, a lot of commercialism has taken place. A person writes a book and says that this book is dictated by a spirit. Now, perhaps in some cases that could be true. And in many cases, it could be a better way, easier way to promote a book. So we have to be careful if it is genuine or not genuine. But let us take the case of a genuine being, say a genuine spirit. Where does that spirit come from? We discussed this one day here, that within man exists the memory of all his past lives. Within man, the memory of the past lives is there. It could happen that a person, perhaps unwittingly, can call upon one of his own past lives. It could happen that a person consciously can call upon one of his own past lives. In that past life, he might have been a very knowledgeable man. And the thoughts he had is still existing in his sanskaras, in his subconscious. So it is possible for a person to subdue the conscious mind and let the memory box of a particular life spill out. And that many would be called that I am possessed by a spirit and every word I say is by a foreign entity. Now, no foreign entity can mess around with this entity. It is impossible. It is impossible for any foreign entity to possess this entity which is you. What can happen is this, that you might have a glimpse of one of your own past lives and bring it out to a conscious level through words, audible level. That can happen. A person might have had a past life in Egypt. A person might have been highly evolved. Fine. In a past life, see, he was born in Egypt and he might have been a high priest where he did many practices and had gained knowledge, had gained some knowledge. And it would not be impossible for that person to subdue his conscious mind now and let the mind, the memory box of the past life dominate and give forth very, very beautiful teachings. A man might have been a wonderful doctor in a past life. If that person is advanced spiritually now, if he's advanced, highly evolved, he can use the experiences he had in a past life of doctoring, he can use those experiences now in this life. Sometimes we say doctors are gifted. Some doctors with a touch, they can heal. Why? Why? Two doctors go to university, gain the same knowledge, go through the same syllabus, and both could have the same IQ. But the one would have a touch whereby he infuses his medications with the meditations of a previous life. Therefore, it is more powerful. Therefore, it is more powerful and more effective.
What you say is what happens with the healing groups that is hundreds of patients may heal internally through touching it.
No. The healing groups, the common method that is used by healing groups is this. They use thought force. People get together, think very powerfully healing thoughts, and they direct those thoughts to a particular person. And as I've explained many times before, that thoughts are things. They are more powerful than anything that we observe around us. And they can be directed to a person who is ill. The illness of the person is because of some form of imbalance. And with this thought energy, healing energy that is sent to that person's body will create a better balance. And that is what healing is all about.
And can it be done from spirits?
Can it be done from?
From spirits.
Can healing be done from a spirit side?
Are supposed to come through the hands to heal. The healing power is supposed to come through the medium to restore
that could also be a fallacy. The best way is for the person, the healer, to draw within himself the spiritual energies, which is as vast as the whole universe. If the healer is a channel whereby he can draw unto himself spiritual energies and impart it to another by touching that person, then healing does occur. But this we must not confuse with spooks, with entities living in the subtle bodies that comes through us to heal someone. Because those subtle bodies have not reached a state of realization yet. They themselves need so much energy, they got none for you to spare. There's an infinite storehouse of universal energy that can be drawn by the person that has acquired this ability, and it could be passed on to help someone. Right.
Rajin,
So that this body cannot be possessed. There's a well-known story of the Middle Ages called The Devils of Loudun, where a nunnery, where all the nuns are possessed by devils. This has been psychosis or something.
It's a story, you say.
Yeah. But it could be true. Nobody possessed.
It could be a good story, yes. Yeah, a good writer can create that. You know, we have science fiction too.
Yeah. even in the Bible, they've got things I don't know much about, but there's some part where someone casts the devils out of a man into the pigs and they scream into the sea, and that's the end of this thesis. Yeah, but now, what is the meaning? What is the... Right, maybe
it could be very symbolic. Yeah. There could be a lot of symbolism involved in it.
Well, please.
Yes, please. The good and I, the pigs were going to go for a swim anyway.
Yes.
I want to ask something very basic.
Yes.
Just the last question, Bert. Being your secretary and, you know, answering many letters and helping you with these things, I do see that amongst hundreds that do write to you and that receive practices, two or three do not persevere. And then after a week or two of half-heartedly and insincerely trying, because they wanted in the first place instant realization, which I think is a long motivation to stop anyway, they stop and then spread the word that the guru, that guru can't help, or that the technique was not right, and so on and so on. Could you please, for especially for beginning meditators who listen to tapes like these, just explain what perseverance means, what it entails, the importance of it, and how by persevering in one's practices, no matter what, one can live in the grace of the Buddha and then achieve the results.
In anything in life, nothing could come about. It could be a very mundane thing. Even that could not come about without perseverance. Now, in the spiritual field, the first requisite is for one to have a yearning for wanting to progress. If that is lacking, then perseverance would lack. It has to be a strong desire to create a greater balance within ourselves for our own happiness and for our advancement. In the first place, if the yearning is lacking, then the perseverance would not be there. The one or two people you are referring to are curiosity mongers. They don't need spiritual practices, they don't need gurus, they need magicians. And that we don't have. I've always repeated that we must not ever expect miracles. First deserve and then demand. First deserve and then demand. But there are some cases where a person is very deserving. There are some cases where the person is very deserving and they have really come to grips with themselves and have the yearning to better themselves. They have examined, analyzed their actions and have truthfully and sincerely decided to make a turn towards betterment, towards greater realization, then those ones benefit the most. A child who is writing an exam, the child needs 40% to pass. Now the teacher knows that this child has worked very hard throughout the year and should have done much better, but has only gained 38%. So the child is going to fail. But the teacher assesses that how sincere this child has been. And just because the child was not feeling well that day, he could not do the exam properly. So what the teacher does is awards the child those 2 or 3 marks extra and lets the child pass. Lets the child pass. Now, in spiritual practices, the most important thing is the guru's assessment of the person. Even if a person has done something wrong, and the guru feels that this can be righted and this person deserves every form of help that is needed, then the guru will give the 2 marks extra and make the student pass. But when it comes to curiosity mongers that would do their practices half-heartedly or not do them at all, are the ones which are not deserving at all. Because if they do have sincerity, then that sincerity itself automatically draws Guru Shakti. As I said before, the Guru is a channel and he has the ability to pour forth through him all the energies to the person that requires it. But now the recipient too must have certain qualifications. We can't ask a teacher to make a child pass in matric when the child has not even passed standard 6. It is wrong. The chela, the student too, requires the qualification. And in our field, in the spiritual field, the qualification is sincerity and honesty. If sincerity and honesty is not there, then they are nothing but curiosity mongers and miracle seekers. And such people can receive nothing. They could receive no benefits. No benefits at all. And by them not receiving any benefits, whatever they would say would be karmically binding to them. Because in the first place, they have been insincere and dishonest.
Okay.
Yes, shall we break the tea?